So what I'm going to talk about is about the context, or the wider, what I call the late antique context, which I will explain, in which we saw Islam first appearing. And I'm going to talk about one particular theme, and that is apocalyptic or eschatology, the end of the world, the idea that the end of the world was coming. Okay. So the question of whether historical criticism can be applied to early Islam, the Quran, is a very familiar one to anybody who has studied the New Testament or knows about biblical criticism in the history of Christianity. And I think in both Christianity and Islam, traditionalists would reject any attempt to treat either the Gospels or the Quran as historical documents, or to explain away, you might say, the emergence of both these religions in historical rather than religious context or religious terms as revelation. So we're very familiar with that. Now, the biblical criticism in Christianity started in the 19th century, and when it happened, it provoked an absolute outcry. And who knows what may happen now? Of course, that outcry in some contexts is still continuing. So I'm not going to talk about these issues in this lecture. I'm not an Islamic specialist. I'm certainly not an Arabist, but I am a historian of late antiquity, which is the period in which the Prophet Muhammad lived and in which the Quran developed. So I want to focus on one aspect which is currently being discussed a lot by historians on both sides, and that is is there a wider context for the emergence of Islam, not simply Arabia, but the Eastern Mediterranean and this part of the world? And this is what historians of my period generally nowadays refer to as late antiquity. We used to call it the later Roman Empire, but we nowadays call it the late antiquity. I'll come to that. So we're talking about the 6th century AD, the early 7th century AD. And the issue that I want to focus on is to do with the idea that the end of the world is approaching and there is going to be judgment, which is a strong theme in the Quran. And historians have been focusing on that as one of several themes, as a possible link between prevailing ideas in Judaism and in Christianity in the wider geographical context. So that's what I'm going to talk about tonight. I was talking yesterday about a similar set of themes, but on a slightly different focus. So one of the trends that I think is noticeable at the moment is that students of religion in this period and historians are thinking in terms of links rather than differences. They're trying to find links. And one way of putting this is to express it in terms of Abrahamic religions, three Abrahamic religions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. And as it happens, there are new chairs of Abrahamic religion in both Oxford and Cambridge. And the holder of the first one in Oxford he's just about to retire, Professor Guy Strumser, in fact, of the Hebrew University. So, and one of the themes that is being talked about is certainly apocalyptic and eschatology. So that's the first trend. Second trend I notice as a historian of this region, and I've worked on this region and this period for many, many years, is a desire among historians of early Islam and among historians of late antiquity to try to represent Islam as a religion of late antiquity. Not, shall we say, as something surprising and unexpected coming out of the deserts of Arabia, but something that belongs in a wider existing or developing religious context. And in a book which I published in 2011, I called the Near East, the Eastern Mediterranean, in this period, late 6th and early 7th century, a region in ferment. And what I meant was religious ferment, in particular, ideas. Ideas were circulating and new ideas were developing, and in all sorts of ways. So can we link them together? Now, this is not, and it's not, what it is not, is an attempt to explain the beginnings of Islam. It's not trying to reduce the new religion to something that was already existing, either Judaism or Christianity or both. It's definitely not that. It's a historical approach which tries to understand the broader context and perhaps to make sense of some features which are otherwise very difficult to explain. So my questions then are not whether the Quranic message was revealed in Arabia or elsewhere, and in fact the Quran itself is strangely silent about the place of Muhammad's life. It's strangely silent about the exact location of these events. So I'm not dealing with that, and I'm certainly not an expert, but I want to explore some of these general issues. So can I just explain what I mean by late antiquity? And forgive me if I'm speaking to people who know everything about this, but I assume you're quite a wide audience. So late antiquity means the centuries that used to be thought of as the end of the Roman Empire, the fall of the Roman Empire, or the beginning of the medieval world, the late Roman Empire. This is made more complicated, especially in this particular place, because local usage among Israeli scholars, for example, is to call the period that I'm talking about Byzantine. So they would call the period from the Emperor Constantine in the early 4th century AD up to the Arab conquests in the 7th century, Byzantine. Now, I don't use that term because I happen to be interested in the actual Byzantine Empire many centuries later in Constantinople. But so let's say late antiquity is a broader term, and that's why it's useful. It's useful because it can be extended, and some historians are extending their conception of late antiquity much later, so they don't see a big break as happening around 630, in the 630s or 640, as people used to do. And archaeologists in particular are not finding much evidence of a big break then. They are seeing continuity. So many historians in my sort of period are thinking in terms of a long late antiquity which goes way into, let's say, at least the end of the Umayyad period, which would be the middle of the 8th century AD. Some people would even say it goes up to about the year 1000. Well, I'm not pushing it that far, but there is this trend towards seeing long continuities of social structures, not seeing a huge break in economic terms, not focusing on political events, but seeing the long durée in the French terminology. Well, I think this can be helpful. It clearly has disadvantages, but it can be helpful because it can help us to understand the 7th century AD in a more holistic way, not in terms of binary divisions or clashes of civilizations, but really in terms of interaction, intermingling, mutual influence, if you like. So I think my argument is that whatever we believe about the date of the Quran, the origins of the Quran, the Middle East, or the Eastern Mediterranean in the early 7th century was a much more complicated place than used to be thought in some of the old books. For example, in the 6th and 7th centuries, there were Christians in Arabia. There were Christians in the Persian Gulf. There were Christians in what is now Iraq. and there were Christians in present-day Yemen. So I'm going to focus in this lecture on the Christian sources because I know them better than the Jewish ones, but I don't exclude that either. Much of this information has come out in recent work, in recent historical work or recent archaeological work. And there were also already many Arab Christians. There had been Arab Christians for at least two centuries. There were many Arab Christians already settled in what is now Syria and Palestine, and significant groupings on the borders of the Euphrates. And they, as I said, they had been for a long time, and they were major players. Some of these groupings were major players in the period immediately before the rise of Islam. So what I would say, first of all, is that the possibilities for interchange, transmission of ideas, and mutual influence were much greater than used to be said in the older books. Because the older books, and if you take the traditional views, they would talk in terms of groups, otherwise unknown groups of Christians. We don't have to posit those groups. We don't have to look for Christian communities in Mecca, which we don't know anything about. We can say there was a huge amount of travel going on, and we know much more about that, and we know more about settlements and monasteries and archaeological remains as well. So I have to make a final point before I get to my main subject, and that's that the Arab conquests, to use that rather crude term, or the first arrival of Arab armies in Syria and Palestine in the 630s AD, were preceded by a great war, and the great war was between you might call Byzantium, the Roman Empire, the late Roman Empire, and the Persian Empire, the Sasanians based in Persia, with their capital at Ctesiphon on the other side of the Euphrates. And the key date for this is the capture of Jerusalem by the Persians in AD 614. And so Jerusalem was captured or surrendered in 614, and this has been very much studied in recent years. We huge amount of publication, and the Persians were in control of all this area, Palestine and Syria and Egypt and parts of Anatolia as well, for more than 20 years. It's a period about which we know very little because we've got very few written sources, as it happens. But the most sensational event of this was the capture of Jerusalem in 614. And this naturally caused a great furore in the population. Now, it caused the Jewish population of the city to hope that they would be able to return to the Temple Mount to start building again. And there are certainly accounts that say that the Persians were favorable to the Jews because they were regarded as potential allies against the Romans, who were Christians. And some, but possibly not very reliable sources, say that the Jewish population was enabled to start building again on the Temple Mount. Well, that would be sensational if it happened, to rebuild the temple. Anyway, what happened was that the Persians, the Sasanians, carried away the true cross, the relic of the true cross, from the Church of the Holy Sepulchre to their capital of Ctesiphon. They carried off the patriarch, the Christian patriarch, Zechariah, and a large number of Christian captives. Hard to say how many, but a lot, thousands perhaps. And there were several Jewish apocalyptic works from this period. They are very hard to date. They are very controversial. They usually can't be exactly dated, but some of them certainly date from this period and a little after. And some of them are very naturally predicting the permanent defeat of the Romans. They see the Sasanians in the role of saviors, in a way. And so I'm not going to talk about those now because I'm not an expert on those. But that's also a background. Now, also during these Persian invasions, Constantinople, the capital of the East Roman, if you like, Byzantine Empire, nearly fell to the Persians. In the year 626, there was a siege, a very, very dangerous siege, conducted on two fronts by the Persians. They'd gone all the way to Constantinople. But it didn't fall. And the emperor at the time, Heraclius, made an almighty effort, left the capital behind, and came all the way out to Syria and Palestine, recruited troops on the way, raised whatever money he possibly could, and that was incredibly difficult, and he defeated the Sasanians, forgive me for going on a bit about this, in 628. So 2 years later, at near Ctesiphon, right out there in the Syrian desert, the Persians were defeated. Their empire didn't immediately fall, but it fell soon after the Arabs took over. Well, only 2 years after that date, 628, Heraclius restored the true cross and the captives, the Christian captives, to Jerusalem. In the year 630, he came back with the relic of the true cross, which he restored to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, and there was a great, great liturgical celebration and so on. And this is all recorded in the Christian sources, as you can imagine. A very symbolic event. And there is an Armenian writer of the couple of decades later, and he describes it. It was a time of extreme emotion. So I quote from the translation: "No one was able to sing the Lord's chants from the fearful and agonizing emotion of the emperor and the whole multitude of the people." Everybody was weeping. They were so moved. He set it, that is the cross, he set the cross back in its place in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. He put all the vessels of the churches in Jerusalem back from where they've been taken. He distributed alms and money for incense to all the churches and the people in the city. That's the end of the quotation. And we were in the year 630. But within another 2 years, you have the Arabs arriving with armies. However, how big these armies, not too sure. And Heraclius could not defeat these invaders as well. He probably went back to Constantinople in the meantime, and then he came out again. It's a bit unclear, but he was defeated at the River Yarmouk. The famous defeat took place in the year 636, only 6 years after the restoration of the true cross to Jerusalem. So these were climactic events in any period of history. Extreme events. Nobody will be surprised if there were also prophecies of the end of the world on every side, the day of judgment or the second coming. But my argument is a bit wider than that. My question is, in the Quran, we find very frequent warnings about the end, about judgment, about the coming of the hour. Are these in any way connected with the similar expectations and warnings about the end of the world among Christians and Jews in late antiquity? So I said at the beginning that some historians are trying to place Islam in this broader context. So one recent contribution, is called Early Islam as a Late Antique Religion. And this is by actually a colleague who is an Islamicist in Oxford. And he, I just quote him because this is convenient, and he refers to the belief, the expectation of the end of the world as a spirit in late antiquity. He says it was very general, and he says early Islam seems to have caught it. Well, that's not very helpful, but still, that's the general question. And part of this expectation on the Christian side was connected with a belief that the end of the world was going to come 6,000 years after the date of creation and 500 years after the coming of Christ, the incarnation. So around the year 500, just a bit later, so that's earlier than Islam, but it gives you a lot of context. There certainly were a lot of worries and expectations that the end of the world was going to come. Well, we know about prophecies about the end of the world. hasn't come yet. They had to adjust their ideas, but there was plenty of thinking about that. To go back to the Quran, one of the questions is about the message of Muhammad the Prophet. Was he primarily a social reformer, or was he an eschatological herald proclaiming the hour, the day of judgment? And there have been divided views about this for many decades, but some recent interpretations have gone back to an earlier view, which was that the prophecies about the coming judgment are the primary ones. Now, again, I am not an expert and I can't judge that, but I am very interested in this. And that equally, some New Testament scholars would say that the primary message of Jesus was the coming end of the world. The disciples expected it to come very soon. So if I turn to what historians of early Islam are saying, and we find some similar arguments. So there is a recent book by a Chicago, very, very, very eminent Arabist and Islamicist in Chicago, Fred Donner. In a recent book by him, he also says apocalyptic ideas were a particular feature of late antiquity. And then other writers talk about things like the apocalyptic imagination. And we are told, and I'm quoting again, this operated more or less continuously within the broader ethnic and religious framework of the wider Near East in the 7th century and the 6th and 7th century. Or it was a kind of mentality, kind of general mentality. And it was a kind of type of narrative. It's how you explain history. And my question really is to test that, to see, do these generalizations meet my own sort of understanding of what things were really like in the late antique world at the time? And I think I'm going to argue that there was plenty of apocalyptic thinking, but it wasn't quite as generalized and so on as these writers seem to think, and it was also really rather different from what we find in the Quran. So, we seem to have a picture of a general religious development in which, let us dare to say, Islam was a part. But what do scholars really mean? What do they really mean by late antiquity or the late antique context? Because if you look at what Fred Donner writes in his book, he's really thinking about this region. He's not really thinking about Constantinople. So, and that's obviously, in many ways, the center of the late antique world. So if we have apocalyptic writers in Constantinople in this period, are they part of this mix? I don't think so. I don't think we can really argue that writers in Constantinople have an impact on what was developing within Arabic at this period. So we can also ask the question, what do we mean by apocalyptic? It's really the name of a genre of writing. So expecting the end of the world is one thing, but exactly what form that's going to take is another thing. There were different ways. So we can't just say there were general ideas about the end of the world and that somehow explains things. And what we find in the Quran, and I'm not producing quotations, but what seems to me that what we find is the call to moral reform, to personal moral reform. It's very much cast in terms of personal behavior and moral reform. And that's not the same, actually, as some of these Christian and Jewish works, which are less about that and more about a kind of historical scenario in which there will be a future and there will be, let's say, the end of the world, but that will be preceded by the coming of the Messiah or by a last Roman emperor. This, we don't find anything like that. Obviously, we don't find anything like that. So, just to continue that a little bit, the Emperor Heraclius restored the true cross to Jerusalem, and of course that was represented in some writings as a moment of apocalyptic importance, but probably not in the writers, the contemporary writers who were the main sources, our main historical sources for Heraclius. So his campaigns were written about in Greek by a poet from Constantinople, who was in fact a deacon of the Church of Hagia Sophia in Constantinople, George of Pisidia. And he certainly presents the campaigns of Heraclius as a religious crusade against the Persians. But he doesn't really present them in apocalyptic terms. And don't forget that Heraclius was, after all, defeated by Arab armies at the river Yarmouk. And this same George of Pisidia, this Greek poet, wrote a long poem on the 6 days of creation, which is highly relevant to discussions about apocalyptic in Judaism and, in all three religions. But it envisages Heraclius' victory over the Persians as a new creation, but not as a last judgment. One question then is that people have asked is, did the Emperor Heraclius himself know about an apocalyptic motif which appears in later writing? And that is that the last emperor, the last emperor foretold in some of these later writings, would come before the last days, and he would place his crown on Golgotha, the rock of the crucifixion in Jerusalem. And it's also been argued that the early Muslim commanders of the faithful, who attached tremendous importance to Jerusalem, themselves believed in an apocalyptic explanation of what was happening. And this is an argument made by Fred Donner. And it was believed in early Islam that the Last Judgment, and indeed in Judaism, that the Last Judgment would take place, of course, in Jerusalem. That's why Jerusalem was so important. Well, I will mainly be dealing in the rest of this with the Greek material, but there are many works relevant to, in the same period, written in Syriac, Syriac being the language, dialect of Aram, particularly ecclesiastical language, which is a written version of Aramaic. And they were produced in very close juxtaposition to works written in Greek. Main language for Christians was Greek, and indeed later to Arabs. The best known of these Syriac apocalypses is called the Apocalypse of Pseudo-Methodius. Well, because it was believed to be by a bishop called, wrongly believed to be by a bishop called Methodius. It wasn't, so it doesn't matter. But it was immediately translated from Syriac into Greek, into Latin, and into languages like Eastern Christian languages like Armenian and Georgian. It had later Slavonic. It had a very, very wide circulation. But it was not written until the end of the 7th century. So it cannot have had an impact or an influence on the beginnings of Islam or the Quran. In some discussions of these works, a distinction is made between a generalized expectation of the end of the world and what people call these historical scenarios, as in the Apocalypse of Pseudo-Methodius, which was only one of several such works that appeared at the end of the 7th century. And they stem from the book of Daniel, the biblical book of Daniel, which talks about four kingdoms. And there will be four kingdoms, and then this will happen, and that will happen, and then the end will come, and the dead will be raised. So historical apocalyptic is that kind of apocalyptic. It's very different from what we find in the Quran. But there is a general view that in late antiquity, somehow ideas about the end of the world and fears about the end of the world were sort of surging around in a kind of generalized way. So that's my question. Now, one example comes from a strange work in the middle of the 6th century written by a traveler in Greek. And he's known as Cosmas, and Cosmas sailed to India and wrote down his, or says he sailed to India, and wrote down a work in the middle of the 6th century AD. And he, in the middle of this work, it's a rather popular work, it's not a very high style work, he discusses the book of Daniel, the biblical book of Daniel, and the four kingdoms in chapters 2 and 7, I think it is in the book of Daniel. But rather interestingly, he does not interpret, he does not give an interpretation which sees the forthcoming end of the Roman Empire. He thinks the Roman Empire is going to last forever, or Byzantine Empire. So not everybody drew the same conclusion from the same biblical scriptural material. Now, another thing that's quite interesting is that the book of Revelation in the New Testament, which Western Christians call the book of Revelation, but Orthodox call the Apocalypse of John, was hardly read for a long time, for reasons I'm going to explain. But in the 6th century, two commentaries were written on this book in Greek, in this region, one of them by a bishop of Caesarea in Palestine in the late 6th century, the other one earlier in the same period. And it's preserved in a lot of manuscripts, and it was translated, these commentaries were translated into Eastern Christian languages, Armenian, Georgian, Church Slavonic, and so on, and Syriac. But it seems a coincidence, but I think probably it doesn't prove the point, because these commentaries are not about apocalyptic really. They are more about scriptural exegesis. They comment on allegorical interpretations. They really don't put forward a scenario about an end of the world that's coming very soon. And there is a little complication, or a large complication, because in the book of Revelation, or the Apocalypse of John, there is foretold a 1,000-year period before the second coming of Christ. Whereas in the Apocalypse, as I've just mentioned, that 1,000-year period has somehow been glided over, elided, and the second coming and the end of the world is going to be sooner than that. And those people who thought the world was going, those Christians who thought the world was going to end around about 500 or a bit later than 500 AD, couldn't accommodate a 1,000-year wait. So there are some problems here. And then again, in the earlier of these two commentaries, Rome, or what he calls Old Rome, meaning Rome in Italy, Rome is there presented as the persecutor of the Christians, as it had in earlier history of the Roman Empire, whereas New Rome, that is Constantinople, is presented as a good empire. It's not a bad empire or that's going to end. It is a good empire that's going to last. It's not about to be destroyed. And then again, in one of these commentaries, we don't have four periods, four kingdoms, we have seven. So it wasn't very easy. So I think these two commentaries are very interesting, but not particularly relevant for our purpose. And just briefly, the book of Revelation, or the Apocalypse of John, had a very difficult history, a difficult reception. Because at a very early date in the early Christian period, it was soon argued that it was not by John the Apostle. And most Greek patristic writers, most later Christian writers, did not include it in their New Testament, in their canonical New Testament. So it was not regarded as author. It was not included. And it was not included in the Syriac New Testament. And it was not, in fact, read and brought in until quite a bit later. In the 2nd century AD, Irenaeus, the Christian writer, had linked the Apocalypse of John with the prophecies in the biblical book of Daniel, and made the calculation about the 6,000 years from creation. But very soon after that, the Apocalypse of John was rather sidelined, and it was regarded as not authentic and not canonical, and it was not really read very much. So that's a curious feature which those of us who come from the Western tradition are probably surprised about, but that is actually the case. But it was linked by some, it was linked by some with the idea of the 6,000 years from the creation, and that perhaps set the scene for future ways of thinking about the coming end of the world, and linking that with an emphasis on Jerusalem and with the prophecy in the Gospels about the temple, the saying of Jesus about the temple and the abomination of desolation. But we know of no commentaries, as I said, on the Apocalypse of John, the book of Revelation, before the 6th century AD. So let's just go to this backwards, to this period a bit after the year 500 AD. And the key moment was the reign of the Emperor Anastasius, who was on the throne from 491 to 518. And it has been argued it was argued in the past that one particular apocalyptic work in Greek belongs to that date. And we can cite some other examples. There was a Syriac chronicle written in Syriac by a writer known as, I won't bother you with the name, but anyway, a Syriac chronicle of the 6th century deals with the reign of Anastasius and talks about plagues and famine and the signs of the end of the world, all going to happen around the year 500 to 501. Yet another Syriac chronicle, writing of the same period, writes about plagues and portents. But again, that one argues against those people who thought that the war between Byzantium and Persia, which an earlier war, spelled the end of the world. And I quote from this chronicle, it's attributed to somebody called Joshua the Stylite, who again is not the right author, but known as Joshua the Stylite. So I quote from the translation, "If it had not been for the words of our Lord, we would have ventured to say that the end of the age had come. For many thought along these lines and said so." It's talking about the years after 500. "But what our Lord said," that is Jesus, "was this: when you hear of wars and tumults, do not be afraid. For these things must first happen, but the end has not yet come." And the author goes on, "We also recall the words of Paul when he wrote to the Thessalonians. He cautioned the Thessalonians about the coming of our Lord. And he said to the Thessalonians, they should not be troubled by word or spirit or misleading epistle, as if it were from him, alleging that the day of the Lord had appeared. And he showed them," this is the Apostle Paul, "showed the Thessalonians that the end would not come until the false Christ had been revealed." There would be the coming of Antichrist. So there was ambivalence. Some people thought the end of the world was coming, others thought it was not. And of course, these chronicles were writing later, and they knew it had not come in the years around 500 and just after. So they have to finesse it. Well, as I said, the world did not end in the early 500s. And so late 6th century writers had to adjust themselves. One of the basic problems for Christians was the date of creation. And there were various computations. And so they weren't entirely sure what year was going to happen anyway. And a German historian, Misha Meyer, has argued that what we can see in the middle of the 6th century in Greek sources, Greek writing, is quite a preoccupation with chronology. with computations, with dating, and he thinks that this is connected with recalculating the date of creation, because obviously if the end of the world had not come when it had been calculated to be coming, you had to start again on your calculations. And so we do find in the middle of the 6th century in Greek materials, we do find adjustments to the chronology. So I think there was a lot of thinking and a lot of anxiety, but there was no agreement. In the middle of the 6th century, the Greek poet, actually he was of Syrian origin, but he wrote his poems in Greek in Constantinople. He was a deacon of St. Sophia as well. Romanos, famous liturgical poet, wrote a hymn, a kantakion, used in the Orthodox Church, on the Last Judgment. He wrote it in the 550s, which is interesting. And there is a historian who was writing in Constantinople a bit later, called Agathias. I wrote my PhD on Agathias many, many years ago. And in a passage in his work, he claims that there was a huge earthquake which struck Constantinople, Istanbul, in 557 AD. And he says lots of people thought the end of the world was coming. Well, I'm not sure that I would do what many current colleagues do and put a lot of stress on that as a sign of general apocalyptic thinking. I think actually Agathias is a classical or classicizing historian. He is writing a set piece. He is writing about, and he gives you set piece. He talks about Aristotelian views about earthquakes. He sort of has a whole discussion of the causes of earthquakes. So it comes from a highly literary work. I don't think it is a sign of general views about the coming end of the world. So I think we just have to be careful. And Misha Meyer, the German historian I've referred to, wrote a book a few years ago about the 6th century in which he listed all the calamities, disasters, of which there are plenty in any period of history. And chroniclers, like the ones I've just mentioned, tended to record these. It was a literary feature. Misha Meyer and others argue that this caused a general anxiety. But again, I'm being a bit sceptical and Anglo-Saxon probably, and doubting this, because I think plagues and tidal waves and earthquakes happen in every period. They're not always recorded. Sometimes they're recorded and they weren't as serious as they seem to be. It's very hard for us now, at the distance of many centuries, to be sure, because of course we haven't got the geological scientific evidence. So I'm not sure that they really tell us as much as some historians think that they do. And some of the writers in the 6th century whose works Misha Meyer relies upon in this scenario, this disaster scenario, are historians who were critics and oppositional critics of the emperor of the time, Justinian. So it is a trope, it's a rhetorical trope of opposition to the emperor and saying what terrible times we live in. So I would rather explain it in those terms. So I think you have to look very hard at some of this apparent evidence for general apocalyptic scenarios. And any of you might know anything about the Emperor Justinian, but in a famous work of criticism about Justinian, of which I've also written about in the past, Procopius wrote a work called The Secret History, which is a scandal sheet, really, full of criticism. And in this work, he compares the emperor of the day to Antichrist. He compares Justinian to Antichrist. Well, that's pretty bold. And the work was not read or published, widely known. It was too dangerous, in Justinian's lifetime. And it was only known much later. And it's only known to us because it was discovered much, much later. So I don't think actually that reference is either is a general reference to views about apocalyptic. It is a pretty violent piece of criticism against the reigning emperor by an underground critic. Okay, how am I doing? I'm coming to let me go back to Heraclius and the restitution of the cross and those events. Well, in Jerusalem, as I think I said at the beginning, the central issues were possession of the ruined Temple Mount and possible building on it. Would the Jews be able to build on it? And as we know, the Arabs then built on it. And Heraclius's restoration of the true cross. We don't know exactly what form Heraclius's restitution of the true cross took, except that we have that account that I quoted to you earlier, but it seems to me rather unlikely that he knew, as I think I have already said, that he knew the stories of the last emperor placing his crown on Golgotha, and that he was therefore reenacting that message. That has been argued, but I think it rests on a wrong dating of one of the texts involved. And I'm not the only person who says that. So, can I just say a bit more about the cross in this period? The theme of the cross, not the crucifixion, but the cross of Jesus, became enormously more symbolic as a result of the capture of the relic of the true cross by the Persians and then its restoration. So the Christian writers on all these events lay enormous emphasis on the whole of this. But also what we find in this early period, in the late 6th and then into the 7th century after the capture of Jerusalem and so on, we find liturgical feasts of the cross. There's a feast of the cross on the 14th of September. We find people writing homilies about it, writing sermons about it in Greek and in Syriac. We find stories in saints' lives about the powers of the wood of the cross. We find it mention of the wood of the cross in all sorts of works of the period. And it is also defended as a material object which is worthy of Christian veneration, and against Jewish charges of idolatry, supposed Jewish charges of idolatry. And then, this is interesting, because at the end of the 7th century, in the Umayyad period, under Abd al-Malik, who was the builder probably, almost certainly, of the Dome of the Rock, the cross was taken by him as a marker of Christian identity. And so Christians were forbidden to make processions carrying the cross or to wear the sign of the cross. And then the cross was taken up again by the iconoclasts in Constantinople in the 8th century as the alternative to the religious pictures, religious images and icons which they were opposed to. So there are some connections here. But I'm sceptical, I think, of a sort of general assumption without being much more specific and without arguing it in much more detail, that there was a kind of expectation, and much more than there had been before, about the coming end of the world, either in Judaism or in Christianity in this period, let alone that it was feeding in to Quranic statements. Nevertheless, if we make a broader context, perhaps we can make use of that idea. So I'd just like to say, in conclusion, a little bit more about a context which I would call anxiety about the future life among Christians in late antiquity. Not so much apocalyptic in the sense of a specific view about how the end of the world was going to come, but about the future, about their own salvation. And I think that there was, and we can see it from some sources again, especially Greek sources, a lot of concern about, more popular sources, about individual salvation. There are sets of questions and answers. So questions like, what should I be doing? Should I be praying to the east? If there are any heretic, if there are any priests in my area who are heretics, who are not Orthodox, who are not Chalcedonian, can I take the Eucharist from them? They're pastoral questions in a time of disturbance and anxiety. And this was, I remind you, this was the period during which the separation of the Eastern churches took place, had been developing during the 6th century and was crystallizing during the 7th century. So many Christians in this part of the world are, just ordinary people, are going to be worried about which group they should belong to and how they should handle these new situations. And really, where did they stand? It was not as clear-cut as the books may say, as the older books may say. It was not clear-cut at all. It was very complex. It was very shifting. It was very fluid. And they were worried about getting it right. They were worried about getting their beliefs right, but they were particularly worried about which priests, which bishops are the right ones that I should be listening to and aligning myself with. And in some of the cities, certainly in Mesopotamia, in Syria, and in Syria, there were rival groups in this period. There were Chalcedonians and anti-Chalcedonians, or Syrian Orthodox, however we like to call them in this period. So it was a period of anxiety. It was a period of tension. It was a period about argument. It was a period of argument within Christianity about doctrine. And it was a time when the emperors, actually at the end of Heraclius' reign as well, in the late 630s, when he had been defeated, he returned to Constantinople, and new formula was being proclaimed from Constantinople, which was being resisted very, very strongly in this part of the world. One of the leaders of the resistance had been the very Patriarch of Jerusalem, Sophronius, who is in the tradition, who handed over the city to the Arabs when they arrived in sometime in the late 630s. So, to quote from a good historian of the early church, Christianity in late antiquity was based on hope, the hope of personal salvation. And no doubt that is what we find in the message in the Quran as well. But that hope could be easily dented. It could easily be thrown, cast us on one side, because believers didn't know where to put their hope. They didn't know who to trust. What we see in this period is a great growth in the rise of cults of saints, the cult of the Virgin, the rise of religious images, pictures, icons. And there was a lot of anxiety about that as well. There are lots of questions in these texts about what should I believe? How do I know that it's really the saint? If the saint appears to me in a dream, how do we know he's really the saint? How do we know it's who he says he is? Is it a demon? And there are some stories which say, well, you know, I knew it was the saint in question because I've seen his picture. So again, this is a turning to relics of saints, the relic of the cross, to the cult of the saints, to the Virgin, to holy pictures, looking for help, looking for safety, looking for hope in a time of tension. And there's plenty of evidence, and I'm going to end in a few minutes, there's plenty of evidence that one of the worries of people in this period, ordinary people in this period, was about astrology. And for example, in a saint's life of the from a saint who was established, Saint Simeon the Younger, outside Antioch, stood on a pillar, not the one at Calatziman, this is a later one, he is represented in his life, and this is the end of the 6th century, as having debates with astrologers, because astrologers claimed to be predicting the future. So Christians were turning to astrologers who were telling them that the stars were directing their future and not God and not the teachings of the church. So there's a lot of writing in this period, which there had been. I mean, it's nothing new, but it is a feature of the period, which is combating beliefs in fate, in fatalism, and in astrology, and defending the cult of saints, Orthodox Christianity. Okay, so foretelling the future, and that's where we come back to Apocalyptic, was a topic which astrologers and also pagans pagan philosophers, because we hear talk about pagan philosophers in this period as well, who had to be shown to be wrong in the Christian texts. And it is really about Christian salvation and the judgment of God and the future of individuals as well as the future of the world. These were central issues in wider debates. And there were debates about creation, and pagan philosophers in the 6th century were still arguing that the world was not created, that the world was eternal. And there are a number of very important Christian works written, as it happens, particularly in Alexandria, but elsewhere as well, in Alexandria and Egypt, arguing against the views of the eternity of the world and in favour of creation. So all of these topics are being debated everywhere in late antiquity in the Eastern Mediterranean. So I come to a conclusion. I'm afraid I haven't linked any of this directly to passages in the Quran. And that's, first of all, because I'm not a specialist in the Quran. But secondly, because I think actually it is very different, in, as you would see if you started to look. But I want to leave you with an impression, not of a very simple, general sort of apocalyptic set of views in late antiquity that somehow can be linked to what we read about in early Islamic sources, but something different, a very intense concern about judgment and about the last day and about salvation and about correctness. How do I get it right? That's really what people were worried about. They were sometimes, very often, historians say, oh, well, all these debates about doctrine, nobody really understood that. Ordinary people didn't know anything about it. Well, maybe they didn't know about the details, the technical details, the technical theological details. Of course they didn't read all that theology, but they were certainly worried about who should I trust, who do I believe, which side, which people, among these various different groups, competing groups, which of them have got it right, which ones am I going to go along with? So, and I would also repeat what I said at the beginning, that there were many, many ways, and we know this much more now from studying the texts and from archaeology, many, many ways in which ideas could travel. The Quran has much to say about the mistakes made by both Jews and Christians, the peoples of the book, who hadn't got it right. It rests on the same scriptures. It's extremely scriptural, but it corrects them. And that includes, above all, in the case of Christianity, the teachings about the incarnation of Jesus, the status of Mary, the Virgin, and the crucifixion. And all of those were the topics that were being agonized over and talked about and discussed and which divided people at the time. So I prefer the idea that those passages stem out of the desire to reform. It's a reform movement against a background of extreme confusion. Now, that traditionally, that background has been presented as the confusion of the pagan polytheists in Arabia, but there are many ways of confusion, and there was lots and lots of confusion in late antiquity in the Christian and Jewish context. And I think that this is perhaps a way forward to finding a way now through some of these extremely difficult questions. Thank you.